I'm Robert Urich, and you're watching the Holiday Preview on the Disney Channel. You know, just the other day, I ran into an old friend that I hadn't seen in years. I was happy to see him, but more than that, in those few moments of catching up on our lives, I realized what great memories we had, how much a part of my life he had been when I was growing up. It's not unlike the moment I discovered the Disney Channel, and my mind began to race thinking of all the magic and excitement Disney represented to me as a youngster. That magic is still there, thanks to the Disney Channel and 24 hours a day of commercial-free programming. I can share it all with my family, with the finest animation, the best of the classics, original series and specials, and Disney nighttime for us grown-ups. There's something special for everyone. Isn't that what you really want? So why not bring the magic of Disney into your home? Call 1-800-445-7000. The Disney Channel, America's family network.
Nothing like a harmonica to get you in a Christmas spirit. It reminds me of a time when, well, hard to explain, but kinda, Well, I was out in the prairie, and there was this little girl, and she needed help, and I helped her, and Santa helped her, and everyone helped and believed, and I also died. What do you think about that, Andy? Does that make you think about Christmas, and do you believe, if so, help your family?
Oh, yeah, that definitely makes me think of Christmas. You know, dying and Christmas go hand in hand. And it's times like this when, you know, you look around at your loved ones and find out where the joys are in your life.
Yeah, my brother helped me out in a dust-up in a saloon one time on Christmas. Hey, Michael, do you believe then? How did you mail back then to Santa maybe help you out with that fighting?
I'm sorry, I can't respond. I'm dead.
Then I remember other things like light-up letters, and my friend Robert was there, and I believe he was out at the chuck wagon and someone stole his finest horse, but he just believed and the horse didn't exactly come back directly, but then the horse thieves came over for Thanksgiving and everyone laughed about it, but sometimes I wonder if the time got messed up that time, if we lost some time because all the candles went out on the street. Remember that, Robert?
I'm busy at my mailroom job here at Santa's house, so I need to get back to work here.
Well, like I say, these days I just sit by the mailbox playing my harp, thinking about Christmas and waiting for something to happen. But I'm mighty glad you came along. Let me get my brother introduce what we're talking about here tonight, Michael.
Well... I guess tonight we'll watch a movie. And that movie is going to be the 1985 Disney classic heartwarming family fair One Magic Christmas. Directed by Philip Borsos. Screenplay by Thomas Meehan, based on an idea by Philip Borsos, starring Mary Steenburgen, Gary Basaraba, Michelle Myrick, Elizabeth Hanois, Arthur Hill, and Harry Dean Stanton.
That sounds delightful, Michael. You know, I've seen this one on Disney Plus. On the graphics, you know, it's in the Christmas collection. Seems perfectly festive for the, you know, our holiday special. Robert, what made you pick this one?
I saw this movie. I think I mentioned it in the teaser. I think it may have been in the movie theaters. I remembered The department store. I remember being confused as a kid. I'd forgotten a lot of the plot, especially some of the gotcha moments there at the end. And
I didn't notice any gotcha moments.
And I just
yeah.
Well, man, I don't want to spoil anything, but you know, when they reveal the you know who the big who God is in this universe.
Is this? Did we watch Star Trek? Is it four?
It's five. Yeah, Star Trek
five. Five. What does God want with a starship? Man.
But yeah, I mean, and again, I just sort of blew it, you know, threw a dart at the board on this one. Like, oh, I remember watching this movie.
Was it formative to your theology? No, as a child,
but it certainly affected it now in my adulthood.
Well, you know, I am going to say we can all go through and give our initial impression on this one. I had never seen it. And I got to say, I was pretty floored, guys. I didn't see this one coming. The thumbnail did not match the tone of the movie. Better to be a, you know, a slushy dark street with a glowing mailbox would be more accurate. Michael, had you seen it?
This is the slushiest movie Disney ever contributed to. I never seen this. I remember in Disney News in 1985, Mary Steenburgen on the cover of Disney News for One Magic Christmas. And I was like, that sounds like a fun, warm, warm-hearted family fun time. It's just, you know, out on the farm having Christmas.
Seems that way.
And yeah, you would think. And yet not also. Yeah, I had not seen this. I expected all sorts of magic. And
it's not dark arts.
I guess.
I had forgotten how dark it got.
It's very dark. And
you know, once the body count starts piling up, you really start to wonder. And when the
that's exactly how I felt. And I was like, oh my gosh. And then I was like, oh my gosh. I don't remember that. And, but it started kind of coming back to me a little bit. But yeah, I was laughing hysterically. Probably not, I shouldn't have been. But
sick puppy,
I just knew how we were going to handle that.
Yeah. And, Andy, I see in the Zoom background you have your One Magic Christmas poster, and I believe you were the system op of a Rec Arts One Magic Christmas back in the day. But
yeah, definitely. It was a one man show. Yeah.
What's your experience with this film?
Oh wow, never seen it. Until now.
First time caller.
And it might be my new favorite Christmas movie, I think. I think surely this is the movie that helped Mary Steenburgen get her part in Elf, another Christmas classic.
I didn't even think about that.
I was trying to explain who she was to my wife.
Emmett!
She's kind of giving me like
show her that.
Nonchalant shrugs. Like, I don't know who that is. And I said, you know.
What?
I was like, Emmett's girlfriend in Back to the Future 3, huh?
Special lady.
Who's Emmett?
It kind of clicked in, but it would have clicked. She would have clicked right in for Elf because that's one of her favorite movies. So I forgot that she was in
Man. Elf. Wow. And Michael, I noticed there's a Silver Screen Partners credit on this. Our favorite.
Gotta have those dentists right. Kicking in the money for the Silver Screen Partners. This was a movie this guy had written, this sort of, I guess, like one page treatment of this idea, and had been going around Canada trying to get it made and couldn't raise enough money. And
I wonder why.
Super low budget. Well, you see, it's Christmas and everything's terrible.
Hello.
Hello. That sounds fantastic. So he, you know, kept trying to get it made, and the Canada film industry, which wasn't a powerhouse then as it is now. yeah, eventually somehow got hooked up with Disney where they're like, we'll kick in some money. And so they kicked in some money, and then like the Canada like Film Commission or whatever kicked in some money, and he got to make his little movie up in Canada about a magical Christmas.
It's a very Canadian movie.
You betcha.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Well, you know, I'm filled with the Christmas spirit. I'm also, you know, more now than ever, very aware of my mortality. So we should probably get into this thing. Robert, will you take us into the world of One Very Magic Christmas?
Oh, will I? Let's do this. I'm not gonna lie to you guys. I got a little excited at the beginning of this thing. I thought our friend was back, but alas, it was just the Walt Disney Picture logo with "Oh Christmas Tree."
It wouldn't have been fitting. Yeah, it would not have been fitting
with the quality of like a potato the video.
Yeah,
very very low quality.
I was about to say, this is not 4K presentation.
The Peter Jackson AI on this one.
They sourced it from a laser disc, it looked like.
It was covered in dust.
Right.
That's right. So we used to blow off that laser disc on the transfer. So we get a very uninspiring opening credits roll by as something fades up slowly into focus. And I'm not really, maybe it was the moon. It just wasn't very clear.
Yeah. I wasn't sure.
Can moon, I just
maybe set, it was God. Who knows?
You know, it is fitting we did The Nightmare Before Christmas for our Halloween special because this, you know, immediately starts off on a beat that's melding, you know, Christmas with horror and that keeps that up for the rest of the film.
This is the nightmare during Christmas.
So something sort of fades up in the focus where, again, I get maybe the moon, maybe not, maybe
witch's it's brew.
An horror, but... Oh Christmas Tree transitions into a harmonica version of Oh Christmas Tree, and we get our first harmonica. High in the treetop sits an older gentleman blowing on the old mouth harp.
Now, right from the start, I'm like, this is strong hobo vibe, yeah. So this could be promising.
Yeah, I thought about you immediately.
I mean, this is like real like 80s hobo-centric vibe here. There,
you know, nothing beats 80s hobo. When I think 80s hobo, I think of that kid in Santa Claus, the movie, watching the people eat McDonald's.
Yeah, eating out of the trash can. That's, yeah.
Well, I mean, not to be insensitive, but I think of the gentleman that used to hang out at the court square in Shelby whenever I think of
80s hobo. Yeah,
I think of Harry Dean Stanton.
Yeah, now more than ever.
It made me wonder, I wonder if there was a... like a fan club, a female fan club of Harry Dean Stanton. Surely there had to be.
Oh, gotta be. Yeah. Probably still is.
So a stately voice calls out Gideon. And the voice is like, he's like, not sure if he's got the right Gideon. That's the kind of inflection he's giving. He's like, well, Gideon? Hello? And then it's followed by, oh, Gideon. Yes, you're the right one. Gideon here.
I said, is the moon Leonardo da Vinci? Like, why?
Oh, there you are.
Oh, there you are, bellissima.
So we're dealing with some sort of supernatural stuff right out of the gate.
Very pagan, so. By the way.
Mm-hmm. O Tannenbaum. Yeah.
A voice addresses himself as Nicholas. And Gideon answers, yes, sir. So let's talk about Nicholas's accent. So I guess we already have. It's, he sounds like, but yeah, it's sort of a German or European accent.
I'm vaguely European, Gideon.
Russian.
Yeah, I don't know. It's vaguely European.
Eastern Bloc. We'll just call it that.
What was the guy that had in the Mighty Ducks that had the gear shop who was like really mysterious?
Oh yeah. The guy from Hunt for Red October.
His accent just came and went and it changed from all kinds of
things. You
know. So the voice Nicholas is handing out Christmas angel assignments. And Gideon thought old Nick had forgotten about him.
I can see why. He's hanging out in the freaking tree.
He's got a special case just for old Gideon.
Special, all right.
Because, I mean, you want to save your special cases for Gideon, because Gideon really seems like a top man.
He's a real people person, too.
Yeah, he really is. Really reassuring and warm.
Jenny Granger, she won't even say Merry Christmas. The whore! She needs
bad,
help.
Very bad.
She's going to be on Fox News. They're going to miss the war on Christmas at the Jenny war Granger. On
Christmas. So Nick tells Gideon to head to the small town called Medford. Not to be confused with Medfield, Medford.
No, not to be confused.
Jenny will be at a shopping mall. As he pronounced it, you will find Ginny at a shopping mall in Medford. Gideon, kind of
hot dog.
Hot dog. Have a hot dog at the food court. Go to the Orange Julius.
Go to the Corn Dog 7.
Oh man.
So Gideon, he has to repeat the instructions, Medford Shopping Mall, Ginny. So at a great representation of a shopping mall in the 1980s, Gideon is loitering around, singing to himself.
Put me in that shopping mall. I don't care about the people. I'll deal with the people, but I want to go there.
It was Baldwin, too.
It had Cleveland County Mall just vibes hard. Like I was digging it. So anyway, so you have moms and husband or mom and husband are walking through the hustle and bustle as their daughter wants to see Santa. But mom says it's a big waste of time and she's kind of poo pooing everything.
No, that's not all she says. I think she says something like, you're going to get a smack in a minute. You remember that line? I was like, time. Yeah, take me right back to the 80s.
Yeah, exactly. Martial law.
So Gideon creepily starts to follow them.
So creepy.
This had a dark soundtrack playing. I mean, this movie would have a very different tone. Like he started his turn and went dun, started following. Like,
yeah, well, it does happen later on, but
yeah, it certainly does.
Yeah, it comes. Yeah.
Has anyone ever seen the movie Paris, Texas?
No.
With Harry Dean Stanton, it's kind of Harry Dean Stanton wandering around, like staring at things. Mm. A lot. So this was giving me
typecasting,
Vim Vendors vibes.
Well, he sort of did that in Godfather Part Two. He just sort of wandered around the background staring at people. That's because he was an FBI agent, I think.
Is he a Disney legend?
Maybe people just started writing him into their movies.
Lurker.
He would just show up.
Lurker One.
Yeah. I mean, surely he's like a Disney legend because he's in Avengers.
Yeah, he is, which killed me when that happened. Yeah.
Out of nowhere.
I was like, how did that happen?
So the daughter's getting a lesson in the difference between the real and the fake Santas. And we have an uh-oh moment as the mom is kind of like tiptoeing around the notion that maybe Santa's not even real. And
what's this lady's problem?
What's
her problem, man?
She's wet blanketing hard right now.
She really is.
They stop off at the Corn Dog 7 or some sort of a snack shop.
Mr. Dunderbar.
I mean, I wish if it had been a Corn Dog 7, this movie would have gone
this
up.
This would have been the best movie ever.
Exactly. So, they stop off at the most 80s donut shop ever as well, as Ginny appears to have stolen my mom's wardrobe with a big purple poofy overcoat.
Yeah.
Long skirt.
Yeah.
And boots.
Signature look.
Because she had that exact coat. I'm almost certain that's like her coat. And then she wore that outfit. I mean, I was cracking up at her attire in this movie. She did not act like
Mary. She was the opposite.
No.
but she certainly dressed like her, and her haircut was similar too in a way. But we learn the family has fallen on hard times, a casualty of Reaganomics, most likely, and we learn they don't have much, but they have each other, and there are people in town who have less than them, and we must keep that in mind. Mm. So
I love that, like, the dad lost his job at, like, the radio company?
Yeah, making radio or something, yeah.
He's like, over the radio company, they fired me. The jerk.
Mr. Grumpskin or whatever, what was his name?
Yeah. Who ran the haunted amusement at the park.
I would have gotten away with it. What if you meddling kids? As the kids argue, we get a timely honeymooners quote.
Yeah.
One of these days, Abby, to the moon! From Abby's older brother,
Cal. Is this when the kid says he wants a swatch?
Yes, I believe so.
Yeah. Me too, kid. Me too.
That made me happy.
But the honeymooners quote was a clear sign that this was written by people who had absolutely no idea of what kids in the 80s were saying to each other. Because I would... Yeah, they love the honeymooners. The kids do.
Gleason mania was sweeping the country, man.
So as we said, Dad got canned from his job back in June and hasn't worked since. So, man, yeah.
This is like Christmas in the Dust Bowl vibes already.
You gotta go to California and get some work.
Yeah,
it's good. Good commercial for Canada. Okies.
Yeah.
So the family drives home in a blizzard in their 1958 Dodge Mayfield, pardon me, Mayfair.
I wondered what this car was.
That was odd, wasn't it?
It was, because I was immediately like, when is this taking place? But, I mean, it was then modern day, but the car is not modern, very...
58
Yeah, Dodge. Very out of place.
So it took me a little while to find that out. I had to go dig around for a little while on the internet before
Big, big Fallout vibes.
So as they're driving down the street, gangs of out-of-work hockey players are roaming around.
Hey, how's it going, eh? Hey, so, hey, out of the street, you hoser.
You guys want a hockey?
Pull over, you hoser.
Play hockey?
Oh, sure.
What's the Donald Duck or what would they say? Hockey one, hockey two?
Hockey one, hockey two.
Hockey one.
I was researching the movie, at least about the production. I read that they had a blizzard roll in at the end of production. And they shot it, I think, in April in Toronto. And they needed snow, and all the snow had melted. So they brought in, like, I think somewhere in the neighborhood of 30 dump truck loads of snow from up north and dumped it all over town. And then...
I had wondered.
That's why everything was so slushy and yucky looking. Super
slushy, yeah.
And then they got the blizzard for this shot and then and a few other shots, exteriors. So Gideon continues to lurk in a not-so-subtle manner up and down the street. Jack wants to tinker in the basement on some bikes he's fixed up for the neighbor kids. Jenny says they have to move in 10 days, and he needs to get to work.
Get to work. Wow. What are you going to go to the basement?
Why aren't you packing? Go pack.
Oh, wait a second. I got to tell the story. When we were moving out of our childhood home, we decided to document the house, my brother and I did, and we, you know, walk around and did like a tour of the house in the background.
Like on video camera.
Yeah, video camera.
With video camera.
In the background of many of these scenes, you hear my dad going, "Go pack! Go pack! Come on, go pack! Why aren't you packing?
Well,
why aren't you packing?
We need to find that video. Maybe we can insert him into that's into another episode.
That's a real holy grail right there. That one's.
I think I've seen part of that. I think you showed me some of that. That's good. So, in walks the poor man's Chris Maloney, as I call him, or Elias. How do you pronounce his last name?
Cotillas? I don't know. Cotillas.
Cotillas. So Elias Cotillas, yeah.
It's Casey Jones from Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, the 80s one.
In his first movie role.
His first movie role. I guess he's known as Elias to his mother, but he's known as that guy to everybody else in the world, I think, because he's very recognizable. And again, like you said, this was his first movie. So.
Hey, did they ever say who he is in this movie?
Yeah, no. I think he's Uncle the Eddie. Husband of the
It's Uncle Eddie.
Neighbor. Oh, is it Uncle Eddie?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Okay. I missed that.
Could have been Chris Elliott cast in this role.
Yeah.
Looking good today, Jenny.
So the guy, that guy and Jack go to work on the bikes, much to his wife's grumpiness. She's just like, go work on the bike.
She's really grumping.
Yeah.
Beyond the pale. Yeah.
We find out that Jack's a bike inventor, and he's got this design that's going to earn him some serious money, because there's one thing that'll rake in the cash is a good bike design.
Yeah, bikes are just waiting for new designs, you know? There's,
yeah.
I mean, think how long it's been since there was a real quantum leap in bike design.
The
world is waiting just for you.
Exactly. Outside, Gideon is looking around, and he seemingly makes it stop snowing as he watches the unemployed hockey players play, as the kids talk about not having much and how Abby's mom doesn't like Christmas. And Gideon creeps up on the kids and starts asking questions about their mom.
I'm a friend.
A major league red flag for kids out there.
Yeah, I mean, I remember when we were kids, we had a lot of talk about strangers and, like, candy and cars.
I mean, the 80s was the official stranger danger decade.
Yeah. Also, the hockey players noticing that it stopped snowing, like, that's something that couldn't happen. And we're like, oh, hey, what's going on here?
Oh, stop snowing, eh?
What happened?
I'm sorry, Spike.
So Cal asks who he is, and Gideon says, I'm just a friend, just a friend. Again, go away. Don't hang around this guy.
My friend in his, like, cowboy hat and duster.
Cowboy hat, duster, saying you're a friend. That's probably not a friend. That's
somebody
who means to do you harm.
There's not enough... not enough PSAs in Canada.
These kids needed to be watching another Disney production, Too Smart for Strangers, featuring Winnie the Pooh.
There we go.
So Gideon scolds the unemployed hockey players for not being careful with the little kids around, and one of them scoffs, "I eat snow, mister."
So, loved it.
Just then, an errant hockey puck flies at them, and with a dip of his head, Gideon seemingly makes the puck teleport into another dimension and back out again and through a neighbor's window. Why not make it fly into a vacant lot? Why break a window? A little confusing why that was better. But
yeah,
that's better than getting hit with a hockey puck. But
is that the spirit of Christmas?
If you can make it move wherever you want, why would you destroy somebody's property with it?
Because he wanted to punish them. It's the only answer.
I guess so, yeah. He's a vengeful angel.
Yeah, so. Angel.
Yes. He's an Old Testament angel.
The kids seem unfazed by it. They just run off like, oh, that's weird.
Yeah, no one seems to notice that the puck went at like a total tangent angle to...
We get a good, this is nice look from Gideon. He saunters off. So,
which is nice. Yes, I did that.
Yes, back home, Ginny is packing as Frank Grump. Is it really Grump?
Crump.
It's Frank Crump, but the kids said call him Grump.
Grump, that's right. Okay, so Jack's former boss barges in to show the guy that took Jack's job their new home.
Because they're living in company housing.
Yeah.
Yeah,
it's where they get there, man.
So they got to get out. Can we take a moment to talk about the giant poster of bread that's on the wall in the kitchen?
I missed that.
Oh, there's a giant, like, poster. It's just a picture of, it's like if there was an ad for, like, Olive Garden breadsticks or something. It's just a giant poster of, like, bread, like,
just
lovingly arranged. Yeah. In soft focus.
And I liked the I like the kid. The kid comes in right when this crump guy shows up, and he just falls over.
Yeah, it was a weird take. Yeah, I didn't know if that was like an accident or. But Mary, she just rolls with him. He's like, "Get up! Quit fooling around."
You're getting
like,
snow everywhere, she says, and I was like, "Snow? Yeah, that's right." I think she ad-libbed that because that was nice.
Yeah, so we get an awkward exchange. The tenants are not too happy with some of Jeannie's design taste, and I would have liked if they had pointed out the bread. You really like bread, don't you?
Yeah. Well, someone likes their carbs.
But I mean, I guess. Also in this house, like they've like distressed all the doors and some of the walls to be like really decrepit. It's like, and they're acting like this landlord is the worst, which I mean, that is poor form, but also, y'all aren't keeping the house in really good shape.
No.
No. I imagine there could be some better tenants. Doors. Stupid doors.
The old man Crump leaves, and Abby says her daddy said he's a dork to him. And why is the boss, like, shouldn't an HR rep be doing this part? Like,
yeah, the boss.
Why is the boss taking the time?
I'll take you and show you off the house, folks.
Anyway. So Jenny is in the shower now, getting ready for her work, and is blowing off some steam with little Vivian Williams. Stop in the name of love.
This was making me very uncomfortable with where it was going. Yeah. I didn't know where it was going.
This is a horror, you know, trope right here. The shower scene.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, dancing around.
Yep. Unawares.
I mean, I was like the slip and fall danger alone.
Yeah, because they keep showing her feet. And I was thinking the same thing. I was like, she's going to slip and fall. Something's going to happen. She's going to be a paraplegic or something the rest of this movie.
Yeah.
So the phone rings and no one answers. So Jenny, who has to do everything, gets out of the out, and a washcloth falls, clogging the shower. And this, I think this scene, I remembered beat for beat. Like, it spoke to me for some reason. I don't know why, but
as a kid. Horrifying to watch.
You had to pee.
You jump around when you pee?
I guess so, yeah.
But Abby bang your head against the wall.
Abby barges in to do her business. Kyle waits, and as you point out, he's jumping around, like banging his head. I liked Kyle's, like, some of his choices as an actor.
He did a good job. That was so funny. I was rolling during all this. This was great. I was enjoying
it. I got to say, I mean, that did kind of scan as a little bit of reality as a parent. Like, the kid who has an emergency locks the door, like, can't get out. No need to lock the door because nobody's going to go in. A lot of that.
I love how she's like, "Do you need to lock the door?" And she's like, "Yes." Yes, I do.
So Jenny's out waiting. She's out waiting for the traffic to subside in her towel.
Also, who leaves the shower running when you get out?
That's a good, good point. Good point.
They're just swimming in water up in Canada.
Shower fills up as all the kids go in, and then Molly, who's the neighbor kid, comes in and helps herself, and it starts overflowing while Molly's on the john.
Molly, played by Sarah Polley.
Oh, that was Sarah Polley. I thought I recognized her. Okay.
A very, very young Sarah Polley.
I kept thinking that like something like horrible happened after this scene, but no, it just cuts to Cal and Abby cleaning up, and I was like, oh, I don't remember that.
Yeah, part. There was a lot of foreshadowing to something really terrible.
It's a slow build.
I thought water was going to drip through the floor, and it was going to hit the dad down in the basement working on
the and electrocute him because he's in bare feet.
Yeah.
Now, nothing like that would ever happen in one magic
it's
Christmas.
True. Yeah, it was silly to think guys could be that morbid.
But Cal actually breaks the window with the mop handle as they're cleaning up. So it's sort of anticlimactic in my book.
But, which, I mean, when you're giving your, like, what, like, 7-year-old maybe kid a big mop, you're kind of asking for that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
and they're getting ready to move out, so I mean, why not?
Well, that's a few true
windows,
yeah.
Big deal.
Frank Crump gets what he deserves.
That's right.
They didn't put on a security deposit when they moved in.
So Abby's at work at Glenn's Market, which
you don't like yellow. How about this? How about not liking windows?
I'll leave you some yellow. I leave yellow all over the place.
The Jenny's at work at Glenn's Market, making her blue light special announcements for her stuffy, introverted boss, Herbert, or Herbie, as she calls him. She deals with her customers being jerks, and Herbie gives Ginny some grief, and a fellow employee who just got back from the Wham concert sticks up for her.
Awesome. That was weird. I like there's an A&P shout out because the guy's like, I'll go to A&P next time. Like, you never expect to hear A&P pop up anywhere.
And the feedback on the microphone.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, that was good. So good.
Gotta have it.
I think this scene was filmed in the Ingalls in Midtown Franklin.
Oh man, totally. Totally. I see that place that my wife is always petrified to go into. It's like, it's gonna smell like bleach in there. I'm like, well, it's clean.
That means it's clean.
There's a lot of department stores in Franklin I don't like going into, but
yeah, it makes sense.
This really was immediately, it took me back to the 80s though when I saw all this, because there's so many things.
Oh, totally.
And I mean, grocery stores, for real, they were like, it was a vibe for sure.
Just definitely. Like, even her having to like enter everything into the register and then like void it out, and just all that like little stuff.
Cash and check only, no credit cards. And
yeah, right.
It was the longest time before they started taking credit cards at grocery stores for some weird reason.
People paying in nickels.
Yep. Expected to see Ruben up in there.
Ruben shout out. Oh man. Ginny's neighbor, Mrs. Morg, Monahan is checking out next as Gideon creeps around at the snacks food aisle. Mrs. Monahan only has $25 worth of food stamps, and we see Reaganomics hard at work again, although this was a shot in Canada, so maybe it was the Prime Minister, Brian.
Another welfare queen.
Yeah, Nomics. So
Mulroney,
we'd like to thank you, Brian Mulroney.
I was wondering if you guys would pick up on. I had to go look him up. Like, I was trying to think.
We were really dialed into Mulroney. Oh,
know him from the annual Walt Disney World Christmas parade, where they have a little filmed message from
and mostly Brian Mulroney. What was it called? Double Exposure? Was that what that show was called on shortwave radio? Yeah.
The Jack is out putting the angel at the town square on the tree instead of looking for a job, as Gideon lurks around some more. Cue the harmonica.
Let me ask you guys, are you angel on the top of tree people or star?
We typically go with a star.
Yeah. How do you not know this?
I leave the tree strictly to my wife.
Okay.
It's a thing around here. So
we flip flop back and forth. It depends on what we're feeling that year.
I'm all star all the time, baby.
Yeah.
Yeah. I've got a little Harry Dean Stanton I put up there.
I put BZ up there. Sorry. I really want to watch Santa Claus the movie.
Earlier in my notes, this is very Santa Claus the movie adjacent with the heavy 80s poverty.
It is.
Having ketchup for lunch at school.
Is that a Disney movie? Because I've never seen that one.
Oh, man. Oh, can we just watch that?
It's not, but you need to check it out.
Yeah, you need to check it out.
Like, is it it's Fox? Up there with Taxi. I mean, okay. With Taxi Driver.
Got it.
It's more like Mean Streets, I guess, or King of Comedy.
All right, back at the house, Abby's getting ready for bed and wants to know what angels are. Jack says they're all kinds of angels and they're invisible.
Oh, shout out to the Fruit of the Loom commercial that's on TV.
Yes.
Oh, I missed that.
Yeah, guys,
their outfits. There were some good commercials in the background. There was one for the Kodak with the little like the camera with the disc film.
Oh, the disc camera. Yeah,
they had one of those on. Yeah.
I missed that one.
Downstairs, Ginny and Jack are talking about money and discussing toys for the kids for Christmas. Abby and Cal are at the top of the stairs and they overhear everything. And Cal explains that Santa gets them a few things, but Mom and Dad get the rest. And that's kind of how it works. So, but Abby's worried.
But mom's been out shopping, though. She's been out shopping. Yep. She got an Etch-A-Sketch and a tea set. And she's like, yeah, and the dad's like, oh, well, I guess we'll go out tomorrow and get the rest. She's like, no.
That's
just Etch-A-Sketch.
Salt.
Abby's worried Santa isn't coming because she forgot to write Santa a letter this year.
Oops, so write him a letter.
Yeah, what are you waiting on?
Come on.
So back in the kitchen, Jack wants to take out some money for their from their savings. And Jenny says, no way, Jose. We're not touching the savings over my dead body. Ain't happening.
No to everything. Rah!
So Abby pins a letter to Santa. And Jenny and Jack are having some pillow talk about Santa in their bedroom now, which gets Jenny a little frisky for some strange reason. Yeah,
what the heck?
I know. It was just like...
She likes his childlike wonder.
Yeah, give me a kiss. Yes.
Give us a kiss.
So while mom and dad are getting, you know, quote unquote busy, Abby sneaks out and delivers the letter to the post box on the street.
Oh, good Lord.
Is she? You can tell it's the 80s because the kids can just leave the house in the middle of the night and then run down the street.
Yep.
Is this when she's wearing her Mogwai shirt, or did I miss that?
Oh, yeah, that was earlier. Yeah. That's good. That was, I think, when they were in the stairway talking about presents, she was wearing her Mogwai t-shirt. Nice. Yeah.
She put on a little coat.
The Gideon, who likes to climb trees, is sitting up precariously close to some power lines singing and notices Abby running out to the mailbox. Then he magically appears next to the mailbox.
Yeah. So why does he choose the most startling ways to present himself?
Exactly.
Not a good angel here. He's really kind of phoning it in, I think, a little bit.
Also,
Gideon, you should be a people person.
You're like acting like the Mona Lisa right now. She was not too nice.
Yeah, Harry Dean Stanton does not look thrilled either to be out in the cold. Because he's
Well, I got thinking like Buddy Epson probably would have been a better angel.
Yeah, dog.
Somebody with Buddy a little Epson more personality and
it's Elliot in there. I mean, yeah, we could recast this thing real quick.
You could have gotten who he was. He played the mechanic in the first Herbie movie.
Buddy Hackett.
I mean, that's
Buddy Hackett. Yeah.
He would have been a good, I think, angel.
He would have been, actually. I mean, it would have been a lot more disarming than what we got.
But he magically appears next to the mailbox, and a bright light emerges. He retrieves Abby's letter.
Special effect.
Magic.
But what kind of weird thing is that to do? Like, psych.
Whoop. Yep, got it. Watch this, kid.
Let's add another red flag to the stranger danger here. You got this weird guy who's hanging outside in trees in your neighborhood, teleporting hockey pucks through windows and retrieving letters with strange light.
Also, probably a federal offense.
I was just going to say that.
Shouldn't be tampering with the money. I don't. Maybe in Canada,
you can
get away with it.
Socialism.
Anything goes in Canada.
Socialists. Yeah. All the mail belongs to everybody.
Gideon asks Abby if she can keep a secret. Again, red flag here.
Yeah.
Bringing him into confidence. Yeah. Not good.
He says he's an angel. And he was once a cowhand out west.
Oh, man.
And one Christmas, he drowned in the Snake River when he tried to save a kid.
But can we about when he's telling this story, they play like Foley that tells the story to.
Weird splash.
This is like water sounds and splashes.
I didn't even.
It's so
that.
Weird, guys. This is really taking a turn.
This is a really weird way.
It's getting. It's even weirder, weird,
but it's so great. I really am enjoying it.
It's like seasonal affective disorder. The movie.
Oh, man. So he became a Christmas angel because I guess he died on Christmas saving somebody.
Saving them. Didn't save
myself. His job is to help one person every Christmas who's down and to have let them have a better. He could have done this job like in maybe 30 minutes. Like,
yeah.
He does not need to be devoting this much time to.
He's a loafer, man. He's just lurking around.
He's a lurker. Yep, yep. He spends way too much time lurking and not enough time doing.
Yes, he was in this grocery store. What's up in this tree? Yeah.
Yeah, I guess I don't want to give away the plot. I was going to say he could have delivered a token to remind Ginny of.
Yeah, he could have, couldn't he?
He could have just slipped it into the front, into the mail slot, and then she would have been like, "Oh, I remember Christmas. Oh, wow. Okay, maybe things aren't so bad after all." But anyway, here we are. Ginny finds out that Abby's missing, and Gideon tells her to take this letter that she wrote and pulled it from the mailbox and take it to her mom and let her mom mail it instead, and to keep it a secret and that he's an angel. So I don't understand the logic behind that, but whatever. Ginny sees Abby, who darts out in front of a car, and a bright light flashes and seemingly Abby time shifts, I guess.
What is that about?
Loved it.
Abby is a Romulan cloaking device actually phased her. And the car went through her.
Man, this movie is coming at you in so many ways. I mean, it's just teasing you. It's like, you know, something's going to happen. And it
goes so hard right from the start. Yeah.
Gotcha.
It's like
Abby teleports. Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
This was totally pointless, right? There's no point to this except just to be like, oh,
just to stress gonna get run out. Over.
Yeah.
Horror.
The escalating series of dares.
Abby teleports back and the car misses her, and she seemingly doesn't even know, like, she almost died. But Abby breaks
nothing learned.
First rule of Magic Christmas, though, and she talks about Magic Christmas to her mom and immediately tells her that Gideon's an angel. So
she after being warned like five times not to tell, immediately tells.
Can I just say that that's also very accurate? That would be the way it would go down for real.
For sure.
Abby, the first rule of Magic Christmas, you do not talk about Magic Christmas. Don't talk
about like, Magic a snowball Christmas. Should have just flown out of nowhere and hit her right when that happened. And then
the hockey puck never went into the window. It comes out.
It finally comes out and hits her.
I'm starting to realize we're really in for a long haul when this is going on, guys.
Oh, yes. So anyway, she tells mom that Gideon saved her. So I guess she did realize she almost died. But Ginny wisely says to her, don't talk to strangers.
Yeah.
Yes.
There it is.
Right, it's right there.
They're covering their bases, man. That's a plot hole, right? Nice and tidy.
And with that, we wrap up Act One.
We fade up to the Hilltop Motel, and the family is in the car. The boy asks if their mom grew up in a hotel like that. Dad says no, she grew up in a Ramada Inn where her dad was manager. Very useful backstory. Then, when the kids asked if they met in a hotel, the dad responds, no, that came later.
Oh.
Oh, Jack.
Jack says he met Ginny on a blind date. Prettiest girl he ever saw. Family pulls up to a giant farmhouse with a golden retriever. A visit to great-granddad. Later, we see a fire. Ginny is playing the piano, so she has a small amount of joy. The kids ask their great-granddad if Santa is real, and he says, you're a Granger. We always believe in things like Santa Claus and angels.
Granger.
All while throwing paper airplanes into a burning fire.
Perfectly.
Yeah, what was it? Wasting paper. The paper airplanes into the fire.
Red, you know what's fun? Tossing paper airplanes into a lit fire.
Who gives a rip? I'm old and I have this giant house.
I'll be dead soon.
You all are poor.
You all are poor. I have all this.
I can just throw paper into the fire. Maybe I'll make a plane out of some dollar bills and throw that into the fire.
Show you how much money means to me.
Can we go back to the other house, to their house? And can I just say how dire the 80s were for interior design? Like, what happened? If we ever get to a point of such busy wallpaper again, I'm going to just freak out, I think. Anyway, this place is better appointed. The kids head up to the attic of the old house. Doesn't look like great granddad has done much prep here. He looks very confused. Old Joe Biden in the attic.
Kids, come on up here to the attic. Here, let's take a look. I got the impression that was a real attic. Because, I mean,
it did seem like there's a couple of things.
Set dressers either did a really, really good job, or that's a legit attic.
Well, and I have a real set dressing question coming up, but we'll get there. But he's looking for Christmas tree lights. Dude, do that before people get here.
It's a bit late for that.
Yeah.
It's very out of breath.
It was the 80s, though. You didn't decorate for Christmas until the third week of December back then.
Yeah.
People are putting their trees up now.
Luddites. They find the box of lights, and in that box is a snow globe. It's the North Pole where Santa Claus lives. Great-granddad creepily hands Abby the snow globe. He finds the Christmas book his mom used to read to him and gives it to Cal. This is just really slowing down now. Old great-granddad doing his bits. He says, now that I've given you both a present, now I don't have to give you anything for Christmas.
Because I'm a cheapskate.
The kids...
Punk move, granddad. This is the worst bit.
The kids, they show crestfallen individual shots of the kids, and psych! Not today. Maybe I'll give you something else. Ha ha ha. What a great thing to do to children.
Who were great granddad messing with your mom
in poverty.
Where was granddad? What happened to him?
Yeah, I was wondering the same thing. Yeah, where's granddad? This is great granddad.
They did mention generation. Well, yeah. I mean, their granddad died the past year. We get that later on.
Oh, it's, didn't know.
I thought it was.
It's part of the rough year Jenny's having.
Yeah.
Down in the crap.
Well, it collapsed. This is her granddad. Jenny's granddad is this guy, right? Her dad.
That's Granger. That's
no, he's a Granger. Granger.
That's
a Granger.
That's Jenny's.
That's why she loves
granddad in law.
I need a genealogy. I need to go to to look this up. Anyway, after the kids discuss whether or not Santa can see them in the bathroom.
that cracked me up.
Abby is getting tucked into bed and looking at her snow globe. There's always a snow globe in these movies, guys.
Mm-hmm.
I tell you what, though, I got a real problem with this movie here because earlier in the movie,
you got one now.
Yeah, I got a major beef now. Like, it took me out of the movie here because her bed was in the middle of the room when her dad tucked her in. Now the bed's against the wall.
And it was, wasn't it?
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah. Terrible. Up to then, flawless. Anyway, she asks her mom if she mailed her letter to Santa, and her mom hasn't, and gets irritated at the question. No chill with this lady. I mean, kids are going to ask you
with your letter
about Santa constantly, and you've got to mail the letter to Santa.
Ramadi.
Stupid doesn't matter anyway. Stupid Santa.
This lady. Abby hugs her creepy doll after Jenny leaves and says, Mama's never going to like Christmas this year. And she's...
But the doll's name is Elizabeth.
Wow. That's deep, man.
I didn't pick that up.
Oh, that got me good.
That's good.
Okay, and what is the, I would argue, the most horrific shot of the movie? Is she saying that? We see Gideon appear in the dark staring at her. I mean, it's
this is like David Lynch's Christmas extravaganza.
I mean, it is like horror. We really go into pure horror mode now.
Oh, big time. I mean,
luckily, he turns on the lights. He says, Abby's mom has lost the spirit of Christmas. Something in her broke.
Unlike me, I'm a ball of joy.
Yeah, I'm completely put together. I've had a lot of therapy. He drops the snow globe. Oh, man, I'm starting to wonder what's going on here, but he fixes it with magic.
Psych.
He can fix broken pieces of glass, but only your mom can fix what's broken in her life. Can't even get through this line. It's so ridiculous.
Wet blankets are another.
Okay, I mean, I kind of ascribe to his belief that, like, people got to take care of their stuff, but...
their business.
It seems like something could be done to push her in the right direction, right?
Oh, there's something done. Mm.
There's so much that's like, oh, only she can start to believe. Until then, we're going to ruin her life.
Yeah. We'll make things increasingly worse. It's like a stress test. See how much the structure can bear.
If she never does believe, then your life's ruined.
That's right. Oops.
Yeah. Oops.
Gideon, did you fix her? Nope.
I'm going to say this.
You'll see.
I made a huge mistake, boss.
So I made a big mistake, Nicholas.
Gideon says we're going to have to give her a Christmas present that only angels and children can give. And no matter what happens between tonight and tomorrow, don't be afraid. Why is he acting like that? Like, it's whatever happens.
Gideon's ability as a Christmas angel.
Whatever happens, I'm just gonna say don't be afraid. I mean, angels did, I mean, it's scriptural. They always said don't be afraid. Maybe they were going really literal here. I don't know.
It's true. It's theologically sound.
Angels don't hang out in bathrooms, and angels shouldn't be allowed in little kids' rooms.
Period. With the lights off, especially.
When the lights are off,
He says, you can find me at the top of the tree. And disappears, which, you know, I think that could be my sign-off for the next couple of months here.
See you at the top of the tree.
We need to make a poster, so like Jesus take the wheel, or like the footprints next to him. Just a picture of like of Gideon looking over.
Duster.
No, Gideon just standing there in the dark looking over at kids and Lord be with our children or something like that.
Just find me at the top of the tree.
Well, we see Jenny and Jack, and she sees Abby's letter to Santa and grumps about it and drops the envelope. Do you think they're playing this a little hard right now?
Yeah, they are.
Stupid letter. Stupid Santa letter.
Stupid
Merry Christmas. Rah. Rah.
Go pack.
Go pack. Go pack. Jack is working on business plans for the bike shop, and Jenny says, forget it, Jack. You need a job, a regular job. Rah! She's a...
Yeah, we haven't discussed how his grand scheme is to take $5,000, which is their like life savings, and invest in a bike shop.
Well, I mean...
Yeah, I guess I've glossed over that. Yeah.
And she's not into that idea.
Jack. Which, granted, I think, that is very risky, but she could have a little bit more tact, perhaps.
Yeah.
Maybe there could be a coming together here of a little bit more effort from both sides. I don't know.
How many bikes are you going to sell in this town anyway?
A ton. I mean, he's got a bunch ready to go. But he's giving them away. Anyway, he's had enough. Yeah. He pops off. He leaves the house. Old affable Jack has got a raw spot here, guys.
Little steamy.
We see Gideon mournfully playing harmonica out in the dark as Jack mopes about in the street and Jenny chases after him. She says, it seems like nothing's going right for you and me. I don't know one thing we have to be so joyful and jolly about. Her dad passed away last year, and she's going full existential mode here. Wondering what her dad even lived for working at the Ramada. I mean, Michael, at the Ramada, they'll just pass.
What kind of life is that?
They'll just pass you by in the middle of the night. Nobody cares. It's just
like ships in the night. The old Ramada.
I mean, I think I'm going to have to tell this story real quick.
Yeah, please
do. We were on the way to take my brother to space camp, and we were driving in the night. It's in Huntsville, Alabama, so a good little drive. We left in the evening, right, Michael?
I think
so. So the plan was to like stay at a hotel when it was time to stop. Well, there was I mean, there was a Ramada Inn. We were in the middle of nowhere.
Like dead ahead.
There was nothing.
It was, the idea was, all right, now it's getting late. We better find someplace. Because this was before you could pick up your phone and be like, where's the hotel? It's like, when we see this place, we'll stop.
And there was nothing around. We had been on like a highway. And there was a giant Ramada Inn neon sign in the darkness. And Michael from the back was like, Ramadan Inn, Ramadan Inn, Ramadan Inn. And then we passed by it and we were like, hey, what happened? I thought we were going to stop. And he's like, what? I didn't know what it, what? I just heard this Ramadan Inn, Ramadan Inn. I don't know what you're talking about. I don't know what you're talking about with that. This is
just... I can see it. This is very, this is easy to envision.
We've got that on video.
We do have that on video.
You guys just had cameras rolling, it sounds like, constantly.
He got heated that night. He was really, and we were all like laughing, and he did not like that. Yeah, you say all these things.
Look, but it was right
there. It was there. It was the only light source in the dark of night. And it took us a long time to get to a hotel, if I remember, after that.
Yeah, I think so.
Anyway. Anyway.
One magic Christmas.
That was magic Christmas.
One magic space camp trip.
Anyway, so she's wondering what her dad even lived for working at the Ramada. I mean, I think that's a little rude. Maybe.
It is. Yeah. He worked hard to... take care of
what
her.
If he thought is I mean, he gave people places to stay. There's plenty to live for.
Or some people, or some not
some people place not to stay. Some it was in Alabama. Anyway, Jack gives this terrible terrible speech about we live for seeing one star and hearing rain on the roof, and it's like, y'all, you can't just put a Christmas movie together with junk like this and put a snow globe in it and call it done. That's not how it works.
And call it magic.
I started to think about, like, what is going to make a good Christmas movie? And, like, one thing that really helps is in Act One, you always get, like, an overload of, like, nostalgic Christmas or, like, big-time Christmas aesthetic. And then just, there was not that. You start out with the moon in this one, and it gets, like... into like a grocery store. There's just not enough of that to see you through the
wind up in the Dust Bowl grocery store.
I don't know. Yeah. Ginny tells some odd story about a piano teacher she once had and starts singing. Like, what is going on? I am very lost at this point. Why is she?
As they wave through the slush.
Just about to say, as their wet feet, cold wet feet. Had to deal with the slush that they were standing in.
Jack says, if you came on this walk to cheer me up, you're doing a lousy job, and I have to agree. Like,
right on, Jack.
Ginny is left to her own devices to mope about the melting snow. But goes ahead and mails Abby's letter, which seems incongruent with the rest of her behavior. And, of course, immediately Gideon materializes, again, not subtle, says, there's a little late Christmas cards, or is this for the North Pole? Like, are you inviting a discussion here, or just abject horror?
The musical cue, when he...
Yes, I mean,
it was just... That was amazing. Well, it's kind of like a weird, out-of-tune... it's hard to describe. It's just so bizarre, the music.
It would be so terrifying.
The smoke monster is about to come out.
Appearing
out of
nowhere and mumbling. And
yeah.
It looks like he smells like Dinty Moore beef stew.
Oh, man.
She's creeped out, understandably, and he keeps pressing, saying she doesn't have... You don't have a Christmas spirit. You need to find out why. And says her name to her. And then for some reason, when he says her name, she seems like less creeped out, which is
which would be way more creeped out.
Yes.
And then in a terrible bit of cinematography, she watches him walk off for like a good long while, then turns around and turns back around and says, like, how'd you know my name? Like, really quiet. And then he's, like, disappeared. But he could have disappeared. He was very far away. It was weird.
Let me just walk over here a while, and then I'll disappear.
Got your purse. Ha ha.
And then there's this bizarre scene with more music cues of Christmas lights blinking with, like, really horrific music. The lights went out, guys, on the block.
Oh, it's so awful.
The lights went out.
Andy, is this a movie you've been waiting for, Andy?
I was horrified by this movie, and I was loving it at the same time. I do not know why.
Because it's amazing.
It really is amazing that it got made. It's something. We see Jenny getting ready for work. Jack tries to get her to call in. It's Christmas Eve. She says her boss said if she didn't work a double, she'd be fired. What a job, man.
Herbie.
Yeah, this guy. Herbie.
Herbie now. Herbie. Oh, man. Herbie. Mm.
There's so much to be said about Herbie.
Herbie has got some problems of his own. We need the prequel. Abby asks about Santa, how he will find them when they go to grandfather's house. And Jenny says, I'm getting pretty sick of hearing about Santa Claus. Rah! Jack says, he'll find us. Jenny says, okay, he's coming. Rah!
I want to give a shout out to Alphabet Cereal.
Which they had
a big old box of.
Oh, nice.
That was good stuff. That was good.
As Jenny leaves, we see Jack's buddy coming, and they grab a generator to go do the tree lighting in town. Jenny is missing it because she's working a double, or she'll be fired. And it looks like they're doing it on their own dime, unbeknownst to her. There's some good talk about, you know, municipal government appropriations there for a second. I thought of you, Robert.
Are these taxes going to the Christmas tree?
Jenny and her little friend stop at the gas station. We see a guy with his kid trying to sell his car. He says he has to get his hands on some money today. He's got his kid with
him. He's trying to sell it to Dennis Miller, Texaco dealer.
It's the same guy from earlier. He says he's going to go to the A&P.
Yeah, it's the same guy.
Yeah, it's the angry Doritos double charge man.
Okay. Says he will sell it for $100, $50. Well, can't take that hunk of junk. Christmas is hitting everyone hard right now. Dad says he's going to drop the kid off at the bus station for a couple of hours. Says, there's something I got to do. What the ever loving? What is going on here? Why the bus station? Why not the mall?
I died at that. I was like, no good story ever begins with, I dropped him off at the bus station for a couple of hours.
Oh. Couple of hours.
I felt it building it here. I was like, okay.
You were right, my friend. Yeah. You were right. Jenny hears all of this secondhand, keeps wiping the windshield. Meanwhile, the guy gets into his car with a nice University of Tulsa sticker, which I thought was a little incriminating. I was
trying to make out what it was.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Gideon is there looking on, of course, and not doing anything, just watching. Yeah.
Is this town like the suicide capital of the world? Oh,
I can see why, yeah.
Because it's like everybody's sense, yes. Just in despair.
We see another guy get out, which I don't understand. I don't think, yeah, anyway. Jack and the kids pull up. They're going to go to the bank, get a little money for that tree lighting, but don't tell Mom.
Double parking.
Double parked.
Yeah, double parked.
Double parked. Very important detail. Oh, Gideon walks in behind Jack. So Gideon is there and knows something's up, guys, right? So
Gideon has told the daughter, scary things are going to happen, but be chill because it's all going to be good in the end.
And he goes in with Jack to the bank knowing something's going to happen.
Yes.
Despite Jack saying not to, Abby gets out of the car to go see her mom at the grocery store. When she comes in, old Herbie, the manager, gives a raw face. Jenny finds out that Jack has gone into the bank.
Oh, no, he doesn't. Rah! With my dead body. Not with my money.
Well, Herbie catches her and throws a fit and fires her, yells it out, puts her on blast, to which she says, "Oh, go jump in the lake, Herbie."
But what made me mad, though, was she was like, "Can you cut for me?" He's like, "Me? I'm the manager." And I was like, that made my blood boil when that happened.
Herbie for me was like a lost Stranger Things character. Yeah. Well, it's kind of like Winona Ryder's job at the little like five and dime store that she's got going here.
Well, back at the bank, the guy from the gas station gets to the teller window and of course sticks up the bank. That poor bank teller.
Oh God. Is everything all right?
Call the police.
Super subtle. Jenny puts Abby up in the car, heads into the bank. Well, Jack sees the stick up is occurring right as Jenny comes in, and the bank robber shoots at the ceiling. Jack is trying to be the cool guy, stop it with some calm talk, and sure enough,
hey guy,
yeah, hey man, we're all here to get his Christmas. Oh, he gets shot. Straight up gets shot, guys. Jack is shot.
Oh,
Jack drops.
What'd you all think when that happened?
Busted out laughing. And I said, I knew it. It was great because, and also, again, we talked about this in the last episode, but Robert and I have been playing a lot of Red Dead Redemption. And we've been robbing a lot of people. And as soon as we rob them, we shoot them.
Killing.
So I thought, well, there we go. That is like the end of the rising action.
Yep, same.
But how about we turn up the temperature to full broil here? Remember the double parking?
I remember this scene.
Yeah.
It came back to me, but I'd forgotten what's coming.
The Jack double parked, and double parking never pays, guys. He double parked the bank robber. So the bank robber goes and steals Jack's car with Abby and Cal in it.
Yep.
As if that's not bad enough, we're not even close to done.
Yo, we're only halfway through this movie.
Yep.
Yeah.
And then, I mean, I need to know real quick, like, what are we thinking of Mary's performance here? I know they gave her a bad hand. What are you guys, can I get a little halfway point?
I love Mary Steenburgen, and I just don't. She's just, it's just heaped with abuse from the original, from frame one.
Yes. Yeah, I just thought, yeah, she was not dealt a good hand. But
my kids are in the car. Yeah. He took my kids.
The bank robber is making nice with the kids. They cut to the car. He's like, "Hey, how's it going? I'm so-and-so. I'm not going to hurt you. I never hurt anybody. Well, you
just killed your dad.
I just wasted their dad. No big deal."
You didn't like the guy anyway, did you?
I'm a cool guy.
Another
I'm
thing.
I'm your dad now.
Yeah, right? I thought of you, Robert. We have a great hoopty car chase here. One of the more amusing things in the film.
Yes.
There's just these really long shots of these cars going slowly.
Yes, I was cracking me up, and
it's
and then
so
like
funny.
The director was using all these like really high crane angles. It felt like like a Coen Brothers movie all of a sudden. Yes. Like it shifted gears.
It's so
to like Fargo. I mean.
Yes.
Is a slow chase like The Last Jedi.
Yeah, there we go.
I mean, I love the all the insert shots of like the warning lights going off on the dashboard because they're like slowly falling apart.
Yeah. Oil. Whose car is going to fall apart more?
Well, Jeff, it did remind me of the time my, because on her, or on the bank robber's car, which Jenny's driving now. Clearly was missing a muffler.
Yes.
Time the my dad's van lost its muffler.
That was incredible.
They were driving all over town. Sound like a UPS truck.
It did sound like a UPS truck. It was incredible. Yeah, so whose car is going to break down first is what they're establishing. But in the midst of this, we keep getting these weird cutaways to like tree branches blow yes. in. What does it mean?
That was taking me out. I was like trying to
figure
out.
It's very Twin Peaks. Like the,
it's like Ingmar Bergman's Christmas Carol.
Oh, well, Ginny's car, which is currently in possession of the bank robbers. Ginny's car, which is the bank robber's car, breaks down. She starts running down the road. Now, what's that going to do? More branches.
Have you ever? She really needed Doc Brown to show up at this
damn
point.
It!
To, you know, damn it! Take in her away. Mystery Science Theater 3000, there's an episode called The Final Sacrifice with Zapp Rousdower. And yes! There's a lot of similar car chase scenes that are just like this. And it's a Canadian. It was a Canadian production. And so I'm like, this must be what the Canadians did during the
Canadian thing. Yeah. We see the police come, which would have been a smart thing to consult them first. Their cars usually work better. The police set up a blockade. The bank robber goes to pass it, swipe the police car, and drives off the bridge into the icy depths in like what is only like a Family Guy escalation or something like that.
Yes.
It'd only be better if the car caught on fire as it went off into the icy depths.
It should have done like a slow-mo, like Dukes of Hazzard style, like leap. And then, like, the engine explodes as it flies through the air.
It was so good.
Merry Christmas, guys. Merry Christmas.
It is truly one magic Christmas.
Brought to you by Disney.
You know, none of this would have happened if Ginny would have only believed in Christmas. But because she doesn't, Christmas will punish you to your whole family. It'll wipe out your whole family. Christmas if you don't believe in it.
Picking off your family one by
Christmas
one.
Christmas is vengeful.
It is so vengeful. You better
one vengeful
mail that
Christmas.
Letter to Santa Claus. One vengeful Christmas.
Oh, what a heartwarming film. Walt Disney Pictures presents It's a Wonderful Death.
Well, Ginny climbs down the snowbank till her grocery, still in her grocery uniform, and sees nothing but the cold river, a silent killer.
Yeah, you were talking about Mary Steenburgen or Bergen's performance. I mean, it's at this point, I'm just going, poor Mary.
I know. I just feel bad for her.
She's going for it so hard, but none of it's
she's
landing.
She's trying.
Yeah. She can't.
This movie needed a soundtrack by the band.
That would have been amazing.
Just her standing out by the river with like the band playing.
Oh, Jawbone.
Up on Cripple Creek.
We get back to the house. All is quiet.
That's what got me, though. It was that cut.
Oh
yes, man. The empty house
of her
shots.
In the room. Yeah.
The shattered dreams of a bike salesman, a would-be bike salesman, I should say.
Quiet.
Two children drowned with a bank robber. And
empty chairs at empty tables.
And Ginny's back in the shower having a good old slow cry. Suddenly, back on the riverbank, Gideon has the kids in a long shot, like no dialogue, just like him with the kids.
They've returned from the Great War.
And immediately cut back to Ginny looking at an empty bed.
I thought they were now angels because I figured they were dead. So they're angels. He's pulling them in. All right, you're going to be Christmas angels now.
Well, Joe Biden comes in and says, they found the children. They're fine. Everyone,
but your car is still gone, so you're screwed there. But
everyone rejoices. I guess getting the kids back and losing Jack is the win-win scenario they were looking for the whole time.
Don't have that millstone hanging around her neck anymore.
Now I can make some real money. Stupid Jack.
Stupid bikes. I'm selling them. I'm not giving them away.
Stupid generator. Stupid Christmas tree. Stupid rain on the roof. A-hole. The kids get back and say an angel saved them. It was like they were flying. Too bad we missed that in special effects.
This was all Christmas Eve. That's what I'm just
blown away. That is a busy
long
Christmas
day,
Eve.
Long day.
Yep.
Like you think your holiday season is hustle and bustle. You got nothing on the Granges.
I feel like poor Mary has really flatlined right now. She's just like, oh, good, you're back. Oh.
Yeah. They're like, okay, let's go inside. Right. Play Nintendo. Yeah,
so
weird. Oh, BT Dubs, your dad's dead.
On we Christmas. Bummer.
We see Gideon creeping by the mailbox. As back in the house, Jenny talks to the kids. As Michael said, she tells them about their dad dying. Your dad got killed. But he's got to come back, Mom. It's Christmas. Whatever that means. What the heck is going on here? We get a view of the street again. And mercifully for me, we end Act 2.
I love, my favorite was Abby says, well, Dad's never been dead before.
I should put that on a t-shirt. Then.
Oh, gosh, guys, I just saw this. So Abby's doll was named Elizabeth, right? The actress that played her, Elizabeth Arnold.
Ooh.
I believe. I got the, shake the snow globe Christmas I got right here.
It's all connected.
I'm, so, oh, I'm so. Sorry. Sorry your husband and your children died.
Abby's going to be all right. Don't worry.
I'm a real expert at putting things down if you need it.
I told you to not let your water hang too long. I didn't tell you to throw your kids in the water.
I brought you this puppy.
Make everything better.
Brought your new puppy. It's your new daddy now.
So to sum up, it's Christmas. The Granger family is dropping like flies. Back in her room, the newly resurrected Abby is trying to brainstorm a way to bring Dad back from the dead. Cal is shutting her down, though. He is not feeling this optimism. Eventually, Abby thinks, I'll give Gideon a shout out since he can fix anything. I mean, he fixed a snow globe.
He killed my dad. He killed us.
Yeah. He seems like he might be relevant to this discussion. So she sets off to find him. Cal's being a naysayer, but Abby suits up and heads out again into the night alone. Apparently, locks aren't a thing in Suicide City. USA or British Columbia.
Murder.
Anyway, Cal narcs on Abby to Mom immediately.
I'm gonna tell Mom that you left the house.
And Mom sets off in pursuit down the slushy street. Abby makes pretty good time downtown to the Christmas tree where she's gonna look for Gideon. She pretty swift making her way down there and beats Jenny there by quite a bit. And so she's at the Christmas tree. She's pacing back and forth, telling herself she's not afraid. Not afraid.
Creepy.
Not afraid,
not afraid. Creepy.
Yeah.
And Gideon shows up.
And he whispers her name.
Escort on me.
It's senior card gauge.
Scarred on me, Abby. Somebody told me they'd take me to Chick-fil-A.
So I want to recap. So Gideon had told her scary stuff is going to happen, but don't sweat it. Everything's going to be cool. But now she shows up and says, Dad got shot. And Gideon says, well, that's harder to fix than snow globes.
About that.
Yeah. About everything I told you, that was a ruse.
That's just making make believe. I'm sorry.
I can fix a snow globe, but not your daddy's chest wound.
If I was there, I could have stopped it with the occupant trick, but I didn't.
Yeah, yeah.
That bullet's faster than a hockey puck. That's
right. Hockey pucks are one thing.
Still. Hey, man, eat snow.
Eat lead. Anyway, he says, you know, more difficult fixing snow globes, so it's out of his hands. But he may know somebody to talk to.
So, there are some parallels here to It's a Wonderful Life. But It's a Wonderful Life. George, he sees what a difference he's made in the townspeople's lives. From him being dead and not being in their lives. But this is just Jenny's crappy life made worse. So yeah. That's just to make her love Christmas now.
It's the inverse. Yeah.
It's like, see how much worse life could be? Right. So you should probably be happy with your only moderately horrible life.
Yeah.
It's a moderately horrible life.
So it's a wonderful life, it's called it could be worse. And that's just...
And clearly Gideon is like a sociopath at this point, because it's like the day that, you know, your husband was murdered and kids were kidnapped. I'm going to abduct you and take you somewhere else to... I mean, like, can there be an easier way to fix this, Gideon?
Maybe while I take Abby away, Jenny will completely snap.
I just wanted to believe in the Christmas, huh?
Surely this will save her belief in Christmas.
Anyway, thankfully, apparently, Santa has the ability to pierce the veil of death. And Gideon whisks Abby away to the North Pole to do some necromancy.
Now, we do talk about the Santa Claus, the movie from the 80s. I thought that movie had impeccable North Pole production design, right? That was a real strength of that movie. Mm-hmm. Very nice production design. This one, the North Pole looks like a small Midwestern farm with a very small factory and lighthouse attached.
And a lighthouse. The lighthouse was key. You needed a lighthouse.
It's so small. How did they do their magic?
This North Pole looks like the set of a Tim Burton TV special from 1983.
Or it's like a Wes Anderson thing.
Yes.
It's like, yeah, I don't know. Very uninspired in this context.
It's like a stop motion Santa would come out of it. And a Wes Anderson stop motion Santa. So... Anyway, we cut back to the Christmas tree downtown. Eventually, Mom finally manages to make it to the tree. She's not fast off the block.
She doesn't seem to be really very...
Just kind of, she's just put out.
Yeah.
She's just over
it. She was on the banks of the ice. I've seen her die already today. Yeah, she'll be fine.
That's true.
What's gonna happen?
She's already made it. I love how when they bring him back, they're like, well, the police said he must have just stopped and let him out by the road and then driven off the bridge. Like, yeah, that's probably what happened.
You all get out. Whoop, 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 whoop.
I'm gonna try something incredibly stupid.
Watch this, kids.
Hold my beer.
So Jenny arrives at the tree, and just as she arrives, the neighbor dude rolls up in his car, which, you know, thanks for the lift, jerk. We're back at the North Pole, the experimental Tim Burton North Pole. Gideon drops Abby off, says,
you gotta talk to the big man, you know, go inside.
So Mrs. Claus answers the door. What's our reaction to this, Mrs. Claus?
She had a very odd, like, doppelganger Angela Lansbury voice to me, or I don't know, but...
Kind of like Dolly Madison or something, like Dolly founding Madison. Father adjacent first yes. lady.
Yeah, it was like
the Liberty Square Santa Claus hut.
It's a different type of Mrs. Claus, but I was okay
for
with
sure.
it.
Sure,
like, right, whatever.
Yeah,
I feel like it's a Mrs. Point. Claus we'd see in like a Betty Crocker commercial in the '80s or something.
Yes, yes, sure. Yes. Campbell's soup.
I made you some soft batch cookies.
She's taking care of Santa's lovely craftsman home.
Comes up a blizzard, you call me.
So Abby comes inside, explains the situation to Santa, who's just kind of chilling by the fire. Santa says, can't help you.
Santa, the actor for Santa, just off of a career of playing Geppetto in a million productions of Pinocchio.
That actor was like in his mid-60s there.
What?
He lived until 2009.
What?
I was looked at the bottom and said, that guy probably dropped dead about a month after this movie was made. And I was like, holy cow.
Because he was withered.
In all seriousness and no joking aside, I thought he was having to dig for lines. I thought, this guy's got like early onset dementia going on here, like the actor does. And because he just seemed like he was like kind of fumbling through some of his acting. Nope, he lived to like 98 years old. So
He was in D2, The Mighty Ducks.
He was in the X-Files movie.
Yeah. Oh man, you never know who you're going to find at the North Pole. So you can't help. Which again, what was up with the whole setup about Gideon saying everything was going to be okay? And what was he talking about?
Right. So like. I can't, but there's someone who could. Santa, I can't, but there's someone who could. Like, what did kids with dead parents think when they saw this? I mean, I'm serious.
Oh, I just didn't cut through all the red tape. Oh, my gosh.
Think about that. Some kid who lost his parents or our parent at Christmas, and they're like, well, here, let's put on this Disney Christmas movie for you. I feel like they're being
jerked around like a rag doll with their emotions. What's going on here?
I just love the idea of this sitting like a time bomb on Disney Plus, like all these kids like getting on to watch Bluey. And yeah, I'm like, One Magic Christmas. Well, that sounds sweet.
You're not putting Paul Bunyan on there for some reason, but you're going to put this on there? This is like poison.
Also, the actor that played Santa Claus also did another movie 2 years later with Mary Steenburgen and Roddy McDowall called The Dead of Winter in 1987.
Ooh, we need to watch that.
That would have been a good name for this.
I agree. I think it's a sequel to this.
Once upon a bleak midwinter. I'll tell you what,
we've brought up enough where... Robert, we're going to have to think about going outside of the Disney canon every once in a while for some of these. There's a lot of it's like a once a year thing. I don't know, but yeah. A lot of good stuff to watch out there.
Abby, not taking no for an answer, says we just want our dad back. Says they're willing to waive their toys for the year if they can get their dead dad back.
It's going to take a lot more than toys, kid.
I don't even need any toys.
You have to do it with a European accent, though.
Just phrase, oh.
A real boy.
She says he can even give their toys to Molly, the local poor, if he wants.
No. Good Lord.
Santa's like, no, I cannot help you, but bellissima, your mom can totally raise the dead if she wants.
How does this work again? Why are they putting so much on her?
Infidel, doesn't believe in Christmas, must be punished until she recants.
Throw her in the river, and if she sinks, she believes in Christmas.
Right.
And
what is the... Ugh.
Anyway. Abby's reasonably incredulous at this revelation that her mom can save the dad, but Santa says it's on the level. Says, I got some for you to give to your mom. That'll fix everything up, so... He takes her down to his Dickensian workshop where there's an unusual amount of smelting going on.
But okay, here's a question for Robert, the film guy. How did they film this? What was the deal with the filming of this? It's like a lot of close shots. What was the location of this? Some weird warehouse or something?
I was trying to figure some of this out. Like if they were shooting in, they had to be on a sound stage for a lot of this stuff.
But it was bizarrely close. It was like
a walk and talk from the West Wing, but in Santa's workshop.
Brought to you by Budweiser, the Budweiser train car coming past.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Santa, he like a little nip for now and then, you know.
But I just, the director was making some really weird choices throughout this movie. Though. Yeah, and some of these shots, like that establishing shot of like the thing whirling around as they like walked into frame, and just, and the, it was just bizarre.
Yeah, there are lots of various Nordic people working on toys, and things are bustling, and Santa's like saying hello to everybody in like different languages. And Abby's really stoked. Her school's old dead janitor's hanging out there in Santa's workshop.
There's a lot of action. Cleaning up,
I guess.
There was a lot of action up to this point. And all of a sudden, like, Santa's like really bringing this movie down.
Yeah. When Santa shows up, things just come to a halt in one magic Christmas. Santa's like, yeah, people always think it's elves, but I really outsource all my work to the undead.
Yeah, you know, what in the world is going on here?
You know, all those dead people, they just come here and labor and toll for free, and the Politburo manages
them. They make a toy soldiers for the little kids. They make a dolly for you. You want a dolly, a dead man to make a for you?
What is happening, guys? What's happening here?
It's a dude.
I think
the word overhead there, Santa.
I think the words were, when I talked to Robert about this, and I said, I've not watched this movie yet. And Robert said, oh, man, this one jerks the wheel pretty hard. And it's so true.
We do a lot of walking around the workshop until finally we reach the mail room where Santa goes looking for Jenny's childhood letter to Santa. Yeah, the vibe of these workshop scenes, pretty weird. Santa, this is like a set. I don't know. This is like Ollivander's One Shop or something. All of a sudden,
It's a pack rat.
I know, that's they blew the budget on that one.
On that one shelf with all the letters, yeah, and the big ladder. It's like it's from a totally different movie.
Yes,
and Santa demands that to his dead workers, like, move that ladder over here for me.
The guy gets all mad about it. He's like, ugh.
Why even bother raising you from the dead if you're not going to help me with my ladder?
It's so hard to get good help these days.
Why are you making fun of Santa Claus?
Peoples is peoples.
Dead peoples is dead peoples.
So Santa finds Jenny's letter from when she was a kid living at the Ramadan Inn. And he says he wants Abby to give it to her mother. Take it, give it to your mother. Thus will your father be restored to the land of the living.
I love the Ramadan Inn letterhead, too. I mean,
that was pretty slick.
Yeah, that's pretty sweet.
Yeah.
Really getting a lot of run from the...
We should make a serious product placement with that logo on.
Oh, now we're talking.
Yeah.
Some serious, dough.
Outside, Gideon's just chilling in the sleigh. Playing some harmonica as some actual live reindeer mill about. Just soaking it in. It's just, this is like moment of Zen, the motion picture.
So I got a Gideon question. What does he do the rest of the year? He spends 2 or 3 days fixing a problem at Christmas, and then he just...
playing harmonica.
Just hangs out playing harmonica.
Lurk around for the Easter Bunny.
I just like to go into grocery stores and see what they're selling now.
I go to Kids Have an Egg Hunt, and I stand there and stare.
Sign me up for soccer class, Deborah.
Back inside, Santa's like listening to the shortwave radio or something. Yeah. I don't know.
another crazy shot, like the close-up of the shortwave radio.
Where the wee.
Tell you what, if you leave that thing plugged in, Robert, you can burn down a whole house.
Burn your house down in a heartbeat, right. Man, I'm telling you.
What happened to Jim Roebuck?
Never forget. Abby asks him why he doesn't look like the mall Santa, and she starts quizzing him about various logistical questions about being Santa, which he simply answers by saying, it's all magic. I enjoyed his craftsman lamps and furniture.
Oh, yeah.
Which, no doubt, the dead people made for him. Anyway, Santa goes off to do his rounds, leaving Abby with Mrs. Claus, who goes to find Gideon to take Abby home. I would not be outsourcing much to Gideon, honestly.
No, especially with children.
Right. Abby seems kind of over everything by this point, and I don't blame her. She's kind of getting jerked around pretty hard by everyone. Santa takes off in a glowing orb, which I guess went off to impregnate Deanna Troi or something. I don't know. Gideon takes Abby home. Back at the house, their little hovel, Cal is inside looking at a snow globe, the snow globe from previous. And he is not buying the North Pole story. Abby's like, I went to the North Pole. He's not having it. He shuts down her attempts to explain, goes off to narc to mom. Oh, Abby's back, and she says she went to the North Pole. Jenny shows up and starts to give Abby a talking to. Abby explains about seeing Santa. Jenny is not amused. Abby is like, are you going to give me a spanking? She's like, says, don't fib, though. Abby's like, that's not a fib. And says, obviously there's an angel or I'd be dead in the river. And mom's God, like, wow. Well,
what is this movie? How did it get made?
I don't know. It checks out, I guess. Abby gets into bed, says that Santa isn't good at raising the dead, but you, mother, can do it.
What
is Abby's happening? Getting really tired. Abby's fading fast and is not getting all the crucial information across to mom.
You just have to kill 5 more people and you can raise dad from the dead.
A blood sacrifice is required at the harvest moon.
I've heard it talking to me.
Abby's really tired. Mom says, go to sleep. When you wake up, it'll be Christmas, which is Hooray. A remarkably optimistic exchange considering dad's in the morgue.
Well, and her whole view on Christmas, the whole film.
Yeah, Christmas is the worst, but hey, tomorrow's go to bed. Christmas.
Sleepy time.
Maybe Dad's we can dead. Go down and ID the body.
Abby's dozing off. She's like, oh, yeah, by the way, Santa gave me a letter to give to you. It's in my pocket. Good night.
I want to see the director's cut where she forgets that and just falls asleep.
Falls asleep, which would be what happens in real life. And then it just, the bleak life goes on forever. So Jenny picks up Abby's coat to like put it away and she finds the letter. She's like, what? She's confused at first and then shocked when she sees her childhood writing on it. She takes out the letter and reads it. Back in 1959, she had quite a Christmas list, I must say. Wants a Mr. Potato Head? She's pretty floored at this letter. Now, let me say, at this point, I expected this to be some big reveal. Like, because there's, earlier in the movie, there's some reference to like, oh, she used to like Christmas until...
Right.
Dot, dot, dot.
Right.
So yeah, I expected the letter to be like, I'd like a real home... I'd like us to live in a real house.
That would make sense.
And never happened, and that's why I lost my Christmas spirit. But it's just, I want a Mr. Potato Head.
Makes no sense.
Yeah.
Makes no sense.
So this inspires her to go downstairs, and instead of waking Abby up and being like, wait, really, where'd this come from? She's like, maybe I'll go mail Abby's letter. It's still in the drawer. Why not? Guess who's lurking around the mailbox with his harmonica? It's Gideon. Jenny comes walking down the street to mail the letter. And they have a little moment, a silent moment of mutual regard.
And hi, Jenny, the mail don't come tomorrow. Your husband's dead.
It's a federal holiday. The mail doesn't
come. Sorry, I didn't do the accent. No, Jenny. Mail doesn't come tomorrow. It's Christmas. Sorry, your husband's not coming back.
What is
they smile at each other. Gideon says, Merry Christmas. heads off with harmonica in tow. Good night, Gideon, she says. I wonder if Gideon's the guy who puts all the Bible. Maybe that's what he does the rest of the year, puts the Bibles in hotel rooms.
There we go. There's your movie.
And he would have put him in the Ramada Inn, too.
Exactly. He saw her already.
He knew her as a kid.
There's so many better ways this could have gone.
He stood there in her bedroom as she slept.
Remember, I talked to you in the dark.
I drop off this Bible in your nightstand.
What's this?
I talked about the potato head.
You're missing a Bible in your nightstand. Don't tell anybody. It's a secret.
Sorry, your father's an atheist.
you mail that Bible to Santa Claus. He might make your father a believer.
Yeah. First, I gotta kill your father. Then we'll get Santa Claus to fix it, and then we'll believe.
Oh God!
So we get the weird music cue again.
What if we had saw her father in Santa's workshop? How messed up would that have been?
Hi, Granddad.
Granddad.
What are you doing here?
Whoa! What are you doing?
They're making me make these toys. I can't get out.
Help me!
It's like the Flying Dutchman. they're slowly turning into toys.
Oh my gosh.
I have a rocking horse growing out of my head.
Oh god.
Weird music cue happens. Christmas lights start coming on down the street.
I don't get this super part. Weird. Yeah.
They got energized. Out of the fog comes who else? But dear old dad.
Hooray.
Jenny goes running off to hug him. He seems none the worse for wear. She's like, you're not dead. He's like, of course I'm not dead. Which is like, duh.
Why would you think I'm dead? I was like, what's going on?
Yeah, I was really confused about what's happening.
I always casually react with a moment of assurance when people come up to me and say, you're not dead. I'm like, no.
Like, no.
It's crazy.
Of course I'm not, silly dead. Goose. Eventually, we come to realize that he's just coming back from the walk he went off earlier in the film when they were fighting.
What?
And he went off to get walk around the block, and this is the completion of that loop. Death. And he says, you know, I just saw you a minute ago. You were singing. So they get, they get their smooch on a little and head home. Like, she's super excited to see him. He's like, yeah, I just, like, we were just standing over there like a minute ago. The next day, mom is talking about how she's not going into work. And she doesn't give a flip what Herbie says about it. We come to realize it's Christmas Eve again. So everything that happened was a dream?
It's turned into a Groundhog Day scenario.
Delusion?
Or from existence.
Like, maybe it was a temporal causality loop. Like, when that the Enterprise
exactly
blew up,
it
kept blowing up over and over
that's
again.
That's right,
Until Frasier showed up.
Yeah, that explains everything.
What if Frasier had come out of the fog instead and been like, I've been in the fog for 500 years?
But Jenny remembers.
Jenny remembers. But everybody else is like, what's going on?
Who's going to pay for the therapy? Like, what is the point?
It's shock therapy. We will strip away everything you love, and then you will appreciate it. Mom is, Jenny's super chipper now. And everybody else, not knowing that they'd been slowly murdered one by one, is kind of confused why she's in such a good mood about Christmas. She's talking about, oh, Christmas is great. It's going to be great. They're very skeptical. They're like, I don't know now. I'm not too hot on Christmas now that she's into it. Cut to the Texaco, where Hobo Harry is shaking down Dennis Miller about buying his car again. Jenny walks up, says, I will give you $50 for your camp stove.
I love this guy. He killed my kids. I love him.
I love him. I got to go help him out. He seemed like a nice guy, really. Harry the hobo, kind of hostile at first, but he makes the sale. He sells her the camp stove. Even Harry's happy in the end. He says, Merry Christmas. Even Harry can be moved by...
I couldn't believe it.
So this is like the It's Wonderful Life where like George Bailey's running down the road like super excited about everything. And,
Let's go bankrupt. Who cares?
It's Jenny checking everything off the list of like, it's kind of Groundhog Day.
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure.
Like she's got to keep the guy from like, you know, starving to death in the alley or whatever and checking it off the list. Anyway. Back in their neighborhood, she goes to the store. She's got to hit up the store. She's got to tell Herbie, I don't care if you fire me. I'm spending Christmas with my family. But what about all the hungry people, Jenny, that need their alphabets? Doesn't matter. But twist, even Herbie has the Christmas spirit now. He does a head fake like he's going to fire her, but he's not really.
You need to leave until Tuesday at 9 a.m.
He's still a jerkwad, though.
Makes perfect sense, right?
Yeah. He gets a little sugar, and he doesn't deserve it. So, back at home, the kids are dropping off a bike at Molly the Poor's house. Molly the Poor is stoked, bless her, as is her mom. They're excited to get a bike. A bike of the future, which will make all other bikes obsolete.
It's called a mountain bike.
We call it. What is it? Downtown, everybody is getting ready to light the Christmas tree, as previously mentioned, and it goes off without a hitch. The generator works. The fumes don't overwhelm everybody. Everybody's singing Christmas carols. Gideon's lurking. Jenny's happy. Gideon's lurking. Later that evening at Grandpa's house, Jenny's making a check for $5,000 to Jack for his bicycle shop. She puts it up on the tree. Somebody should tell her this house likes throwing paper into the fire, so be careful. Eventually, Santa's mystery glowing orb appears outside, and the kids hear his sleigh and reindeer on the roof. They're up in the attic for some reason, staking out for Santa, because I know I like to spend Christmas in the attic. Cal is finally convinced. He's like, oh, man, Santa's real? She's like, yeah. Back downstairs, Jenny hears a noise, finds a very reckless Santa setting everything up under the tree. He's kind of muttering himself, oh, there's something missing. What is missing? Oh, it's a delight. I forgot to turn on the light on the Christmas tree. So he turns on the lights, and then he finally realizes Jenny's standing there, and they have a moment of mutual regard. And he's like, Merry Christmas. And she smiles. She's like, Merry Christmas. And he heads out. Gideon looks on from a nearby tree. And we cut to black. And then everybody says at once, wow, that was one magic Christmas. The end.
Did you all catch the mid-credit scene where the there's a knock on the door at the North Pole and the great-grandfather walks through and says, I'm ready to make some toys for you.
I'm ready to get to work. I hear you're looking for a few good toy makers.
Or he's out in back.
To the smelting department.
He's out back shoveling reindeer poop.
Go to the North Pole, they said. Make toys, they said.
Go muck the stalls.
He shows up, but it's like one of the people in like Beetlejuice who's like had a horrible accident and it's like, you know, severely maimed. in the afterlife.
Oh, guys, this is, I mean, this is proof to me you cannot, there is no formula for a Christmas movie. It's like this one had, like, magnetic poetry of tropes from a Christmas movie, but got it all perverse somehow, right?
Yeah, I don't know if I've ever seen a movie quite like this movie.
No? I've seen movies like this movie, but this is like the upside down of that movie.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is not a movie that you put on to, like, feel good and watch. I could see this being like a Christmas cult classic where people are like, you've got to watch this movie.
Totally.
We've got to push it to that level.
I think so.
So, I mean, Andy, where, you know, without a very scientific, I mean, where does this rank? I mean, this seems like this is up there for you.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it was just like, I mean, again, it's just so ridiculous and so not a Christmas movie that it's now becoming like one of my favorite Christmas movies. I'm not going to show it to my kids just yet. I'll wait till they're about 30 and then I'll show it to them. But
and you'll have a special conversation before. All right, now, children, we need to pray over. I've prayed over it and have decided to show you One Magic Christmas. Yeah. We need to have a talk beforehand, though.
Children, it's time.
I will say I was not bored by this movie at all. I was riveted throughout.
Very high entertainment value if we were grading on a scale. That's, oh boy.
I was into this big time.
Yeah.
I encourage you to look up Roger Ebert's review of this.
Oh.
Where he gave it 2 stars out of 4 and it's basically he was kind of in awe of it. He's like, something has gone horribly wrong. He's like,
I did see that. I was gonna put it in my notes and I forgot to go back and get it.
It's really funny because he's like, the first 2/3 of this movie are the most depressing thing you'll ever see. Just like a series of horrors and this Disney Christmas movie. It's pretty funny.
Whew. I'm fairly certain it came out at Thanksgiving that we went as a family to see it over Thanksgiving.
That gave you something to talk about over Thanksgiving dinner.
And I don't think anybody talked about it ever again.
You agreed by mutual consent never to speak of it again.
We will never speak of the One Magic Christmas again.
I could have spent a week coming up with guesses as to what this movie was about, and I would never have come close to this.
Yeah, that would have been fun to do in the teaser.
That's true.
It would have been to
guess the plot of One Magic Christmas.
You guys throw out there what you think One Magic Christmas is about.
I wonder what the trailer for this was like.
That's a good question.
Because I bet it was all just sort of like wistful and...
I'm sure, yeah.
They hinting at whimsy and... completely deceptive.
With a lot of, like, make this a horror movie trailer with ease.
Oh, absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
You know, like in Home Alone has like that. It was always showing like the trees and the wind blowing the trees. And mm-hmm, that stuff. Mm-hmm. The same thing. You just use the exact same thing here.
Like Harry Dean Stanton appearing in the dark in the bedroom.
God, that's going to give me nightmares.
The lights going out across the neighborhood and then dad getting blown away at the bank.
Well, I was
quick cuts.
I was like, boom, boom, boom. I was editing it in my head as I was watching it. And then like, the final scene was going to be him whispering Abby's name in the dark.
Oh God.
Abby.
And her saying, I'm not afraid. That was going to be the final cut of the trailer.
You got to get the Jenny in the bathroom crying too. Like that, yeah. That long shot of that.
Or the kid sitting on the toilet going, and he goes, oh.
As the water slowly floods out of the tub. That was kind of like The Shining. Shining vibe to it. There's something about the way this movie was filmed, because it is not like pedestrian filming. Like they went for like kind of crazy angles on things and everything. And it just adds to the unease, I think.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I felt like the title made it out, and then even the write-up on Disney Plus made very it sound misleading. Like a Hallmark movie.
Very misleading.
Oh, totally. And, this director got nominated for an Academy Award for a short film that he did. So that happened.
That's hard to
and
believe.
Then he died. He was like 41 or something. He died. Oh, gosh. Like young. Yeah. Wow.
Gotta look up at the box office this thing did.
He was Canadian. I think it was like $13 million.
Yeah. It doubled out. Its budget just about.
Yeah.
Or it did. Or just about. Anyway.
Michael Eisner calls that a home run.
Oh boy. Anything else to say left on this one?
I mean, I could talk all night about One Magic Christmas.
I'm just glad you guys liked it because I go in worried, and I knew this was going to be dark, and I thought, well, they're going to like the dark elements of this. And then I thought it started getting slow that, when Santa came into the picture.
I was delighted. You've got to cut a hard trail. There's a shot in the movie early on, like maybe it's after they're at the Corn Dog 7 and they're going home, but there's a shot of. Because I was trying to figure out where this took place at first, because there's a shot of like these sort of like row houses, and it looks like something from like a Pink Floyd video of like a single car going down a street of just like brick row houses stretching to infinity. So, and I was like, what is this?
I have to confess, I spent way too much time on Google Maps looking up shooting locations for this movie. And I found the Hilltop Motel is still there. There is the sign is still there. And I found it, and I found a few of the, like, I was trying to find the town square, or, you know, where they, because there were some scenes, like there were some banks and some pharmacies and stuff that was, but I couldn't locate it.
In the credits, they give special thanks to, and they name the bank, so maybe that could help you find it.
Okay, I didn't look into that, but yeah, I mean, I'm probably not gonna devote much time after this. But
why not? Just, it'd be a whole like vlog series, right? Of visiting the shooting locations of One Magic Christmas. Magic Christmas.
Well, that could be part of our efforts to turn this into a cult classic.
Exactly, you got to make it happen.
I mean, we can get Adam the Woo to do it, Jeff.
I mean, that seems like it's natural.
He'd jump fit. All over that.
Natural fit.
I mean, I think if you can visit the house from The Christmas Story, you should be able to visit the house from One Magic Christmas.
The mailbox. You need to be able to visit the mailbox.
Visit the mailbox. Oh, you visit the mailbox. Everybody, it would become a holiday tradition to go there to mail your letter to Santa every year.
Our family comes every year to mail our letters to Santa from Gideon's mailbox.
Like a walk-around character. It's like the guy who does Barney up in Mount Pilot. But it's a local guy who does like Gideon.
Just Gideon hangs out in trees with harmonicas.
Yeah.
Oh, boy. Well, we hope you enjoyed our special Christmas episode. Did it provide you with some insight into angels, Santa, and time shifting? Let's give the listeners a quick reminder as to what the new year holds for us. Robert?
So we like to kick off the new year, as always, around here with a big adventure film. And this year's film is a doozy. It is the definition of an adventure film, too. In January, we're setting sail with Captain Long John Silver on our way to Treasure Island.
Wait, didn't we do that last year?
Oh. Well, right. Hang on a second. Let me look at my notes. Oh, yeah. Sorry. Correction. This is the Muppet Treasure Island we're going to.
Yeah.
Andy should be happy.
Yeah. I love this movie.
I'm always happy for the Muppets.
Well, I just kept thinking about the blind pew.
I'm blind pew.
Also, don't forget the new year is when I began crafting the new lineup for season 6. God, it's crazy.
Wow.
So get those requests in now at info@medfieldfilm.com or on your favorite social media platform, as long as it's not, as long as it is Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Yes, Twitter.
At Medfield Film.
At Medfield Film.
Hey, you in that tree. Can you cut it out? Jeez.
Wah.
Yeah, you up in the tree. No one likes your harmonica playing. Stop.
Is that better?
How'd you do that?
Do what?
Get out of the tree like that and end up standing here next to this U.S. Postal Service drop box.
Don't worry about it.
Okay.
That's it. I teleport from the top of a tree to the side of this U.S. Postal Service drop box. And that doesn't alarm you?
You shrugged it off. I just took you for your word. Now, if you'll excuse me, my daughter is making me drop these Christmas cards into this U.S. Postal Service drop box.
Hey, kids, be careful. There are adults talking at this U.S. Postal Service drop box over here.
Hey, old man, how about I take this hockey stick and shove it up your...
Dumb kids.
Wow, that hockey puck almost hit that U.S. Postal Service drop box. It just disappeared into thin air and then through that neighbor's window. Good thing it didn't hit the U.S. Postal Service drop box. That's government property. Had it hit, that would have been a federal offense with jail time attached. How'd you make that hockey puck disappear?
I don't know.
No, okay. Now, if you'll excuse me, I need to put these Christmas cards into the U.S. Postal Service drop box. You know you're tampering with the... You know, tampering with the U.S. mail is also a federal offense.
Who are you, the U.S. Attorney General? I need you to do me a favor. Can you keep a secret?
You need me to do you a favor and keep a secret? Or is the favor keeping a secret?
Both.
Well, I don't know about that.
Okay, fine. Just do me a favor.
Okay.
Take these subpar Christmas cards and seek out Santa's Christmas card designer. His name is Todd Naprick. He'll make you look good.
Where do I find him?
In the North Pole. He works in Santa's mailroom. He used to be the janitor at the school, but now he does graphic design for Santa Claus.
Is he dead?
No! Don't be ridiculous. Also, if you don't want to go to the North Pole, you can find him at bindandgraphics.com or on Upworks.
I don't know about this. Taking graphic design advice from a weird tree-dwelling harmonica-playing dude?
Wait. I shift space and time. Do all this weird stuff. And you don't want to use Todd? I told you. He's going to make you look good.
Fine, but to be fair, the tree stuff and bad harmonica playing is the real problem.
Now you'll be filled with the Christmas spirit. My work here is done.
So happy holidays from your friends at the Medfield College Film Society, and have a safe and happy holiday season. Really.
We have mighty Medfield, alma mater dear. All your sons and daughters hail to thee, Medfield College of Technology. And while we hold your banner high, rah, rah, we shout your praises to the sky, rah, rah. For proud are we of mighty Medfield.